Well, let's get started with prayer, okay? Father in heaven, we're grateful that we can meet tonight. We're thankful, Lord, that as we journey through the book of Acts, we can be inspired by the way you worked in the apostles' lives, the way you worked in the lives of others, and we know it's the same God who gives the same Spirit that will make things happen in the same way, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're at Acts chapter 4. Hope you've kept track with what's going on. Welcome back, Bonnie. Glad you made it safely. Did you bring us any snow back? No snow? Okay. But it says here in verse 1, the priest and the captain of the temple guard, so notice, a little bit different here, the priest, the captain of the temple guard, not all the soldiers, and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. So notice, they were speaking to the people, and they came up to them. Did they come up behind them? Did they come up right in the middle of all the people? It says here, they were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. So, who do you think was the most upset? Temple guards? Captain of the guards, why was he there? Usually the captain of the guard was usually a Roman citizen. Could have been a Jew turned Roman, but I doubt it, in Jerusalem. And what was he there for? Riot control. You got it? Okay. He was there for that. And why were the Sadducees there? Did you notice who was missing from the conversation? Priests. Priests are there for what reason? If there's any bloodshed, what can they do? Offer sacrifices? Okay. They're there about worship, seeing what everyone's saying. But if they really wanted to see if they were sticking to Scripture, who would they have invited? The scribes. But they did not invite the scribes. And who else didn't they invite? The Pharisees. Do you see the Pharisees on the list? Why aren't the Pharisees there? Because if John and Peter are speaking about the resurrection, the Pharisees will say what? We believe in the resurrection. There's nothing wrong with these guys speaking that way. But now because, and if the scribes wouldn't find anything outside of Scripture in that statement. So it's the Sadducees and the priests that are coming. Why? They don't believe in a resurrection. And that's why they're agitated. You understand? They're very disturbed because this is going against everything they believe. Were they pretty smart in who they picked to have with them? Yeah. And so it says here they were proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. Proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. Why is that the apostles' message? Why are they proclaiming the resurrection of the dead in Jesus? Didn't Jesus tell them, go and tell what you've seen and heard? Did they know Jesus rose from the dead? How'd they know? Guards? Did he appear to them? Did Jesus appear to the apostles? And how long was he with them? 40 days. And so, yeah, they're only telling what they've seen and heard. How can they argue with you in telling what they have seen and heard? How do you know if what's happening to you is the work of God or not? Do things just happen in people's life, or does God really make them happen? Can circumstances change a heart? Yeah. Can circumstances change your heart? It can get you on the right track, but circumstances cannot change your heart. Only God can change your heart. Circumstances can turn you in the right direction to God, right? But it can't change the heart. Because if circumstances could change the heart, then what would happen? God could let us all just run wild until we get tired of the way we live, and then we could say, now I want God. But God is active in everyone's life. Circumstances cannot change the heart. And this is why Christians get discouraged, because what happens? Something happens in their life. Okay, let's use an example here. Not too long ago, a gal called and said, you know, my life is terrible, and I'm coming back to God. Okay? She has Bible studies. Everything seems to be going well. She gets baptized, and all of a sudden, God begins polishing her life. You know what that means? All right. Let's bring Scripture a little bit into this so you can understand. What happened when the children of Israel left Egypt? When they left Egypt, what were they in Egypt? They were slaves. What happens when a slave becomes free? They still need somebody to tell them what to do. And they still see that as an opportunity of the life they had. They get scared being out there. All right? That's what this lady did. She got scared. Because everything she had lived with and everything she had experienced was her comfort zone. And remember, when you get outside, God wants to work in our lives so that we can really experience what freedom is. And many times we're afraid of being free. We'd rather have somebody tell us what to do. Wouldn't it be nice if when we got up each day, God handed us a list somehow, it came in the mail or something, or maybe if he sent us a text that said, this is how you live today. Could God do that? Yes. We even know a statement that says what? Every day, God did what? He unfolded the plan that he had for Jesus. Do you know the statement? You've read it many times. I have. Desire of ages. Okay? Every day. How did Jesus know that people were coming to him? But here's the thing. People get afraid. The Israelites were afraid when their food ran out. They were used to always having food, somebody providing it. Now what do? We'd rather go back, because at least we had melons and leeks and onions, right? Can you imagine that in a salad? Say, it depends on the melon, okay, right? Okay. Shouldn't you say that? I mean, isn't ampalaya a melon? Yeah. I'll have to tell you, the first time I ate cassava melon, you all know cassava melon? It's yellow. It's kind of got ridges all the way around. First time I ate it, I said, man, this tastes just like cucumber. Did you ever have a cassava melon that tastes like cucumber? Cucumbers are good. Okay. They wanted cucumbers too, didn't they? Yeah. But they were afraid. Then when they were out of water, what happens? In Egypt, we had all the water we needed. You understand? For this lady, it was the fear of trusting God 100%. And that's where God wants us to become. Remember, he wants us to be free. He wants us to be what? The head, not the... And remember, the head's considered the consumer. Okay, the tail's considered what? The waste. Okay, you understand? God wants us to be on top of the mountain, not below the mountain. And so what happens here is, in this particular case, what are we looking at? We're looking at a fear here. There's a comfort zone for who? The Sadducees. What do they get from all the people that bring sacrifices and tithes and offerings? What do they get? A piece of the pie, right? Okay. If the disciples take away the people, what happens to their income? Okay? I will not mention the preacher's name, but he's a longtime preacher. Okay? And there's many that have done this, but I'm thinking of one. And I can remember one time I was driving and listening to him on the radio. And this was what he said. He said, every day I come to you and I preach sermons. He said, but now I'm really going to preach. And I thought, it's about time. Do you understand by me saying that? It's about time. For the next 15 minutes, guess what he talked about? Actually, didn't even mention the word tithe or offering. He just said, if you don't support this show, you're never going to hear me on the radio again. And that's all he talked about was supporting his ministry. Because it had gone down, so now for him, he says, I'm preaching. He didn't have a bad message, but it was the same as everybody else. And if the only thing that was going to make him distinct for what he said is making appeals to keep his show on the radio, was to talk about money, guess what? He failed. He's not on the radio anymore. To really preach is not to talk about money. To really preach is to talk about God and our relationship with Him. And here for Peter and John. And notice it says Peter and John. Sometimes we think Peter did all the talking. Okay? It was Peter and John. And they were talking about how people can be saved and how people can begin a new life. Because remember, chapter 4, I told you last time, goes with chapter 3. And remember what happened in chapter 3? Beautiful gate. Remember Beautiful Gate? Who was sitting there? Yeah, and what did they do? In the name of Jesus Christ, what? Yeah. Silver and gold we don't have, but what we have we give to you. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And what happens? And everybody was amazed. So now they come to hear Peter and John. More so, they come to threaten them, to see if force will change them. So here's Peter and John. They're preaching the message that is the hope for all the world. It really is. It's the hope for all the world, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And by accepting Him, we receive life. Remember Jesus talked in John chapter 5, verse 28 and 29. Who knows those verses by heart? Good. Okay. What are they? There's coming a time when all who are in their graves will hear my voice. Those who have done good will come forth where? And those who have done evil, the resurrection of damnation, judgment, condemnation. Peter's preaching the resurrection because the resurrection of Jesus assures us that we can come up in the first resurrection, rather than coming up in the second resurrection. Remember? John in Revelation, you all know the chapter, Revelation 20, says what? The first resurrection is the resurrection of life because they live and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. The second resurrection is when the rest of the dead come to life, and what happens? The throne of God is there, the books are open, and what happens? They're judged, and what happens? They're thrown into the lake of fire. And what else is thrown in? Devils and his angels, what else? Death and the grave. Okay? Anything else? Finish the verse. This is the second death. Exactly. So remember, the first death everybody experiences. The second death, only those who have not accepted Jesus come up in the second resurrection. Got it? And experience the second death. So it says here, after his preaching, after the Pharisees, the priests, and the captain of the temple guard come to them. Notice the next verse. Verse 3. They seized Peter and John, see, now you know why the captain of the guard was there. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, and the number of men grew to about 5,000. Now think about that. They're preaching. How many were baptized? About 2,000, right? Because they had 3,000 in just that sermon. And they even saw them taken to jail, and they still became a part of it. Why? Because they believed what? The message they heard. And I think that's the biggest challenge for us, is believing the message we have heard. Have you ever thought the message you heard may not be totally true? You ever believed it? That there might be some little little intricacies that are just a little bit off? You ever thought that? See? Well, see, you're being honest. Because you should question that maybe some of the stuff you were taught was not really the gospel. You understand? You always got to be careful. You always got to be careful what is taught you. I've told you about the gal, maybe some of you did not hear. Told you about the gal we had in college. All her life, her parents told her everything to believe, and she believed it. Believed everything. And I can remember her in college that somebody said to her, "Why do you always wear long dresses down to your ankles? And why do you always wear long sleeves? You don't wear makeup. You keep your hair tied up. You never let it down." Well, this bothered her. And I can remember she was in one of my classes, and some of us guys were together, and we were talking, and she said that. And one of the guys, before I spoke, said to her, "Yeah, that's just rules and regulations. When you experience Jesus, none of these things will matter." So you know what she did. What do you think she did? She cut those skirts off to above the knee. Started wearing makeup. Let her hair down. You know, tried everything. Can I say that? And you pretty much know what that might mean. You're a college student. Never had it. And I can remember after the second year in college, she didn't even look the same. In fact, she had a reputation on the college campus. Not a good reputation. You know what happened, right? She got pregnant. She didn't even know who the guy was. And now she's crying. She said, "I've sinned against God. He'll never forgive me. Never forgive me. All those things I did." Because she only knew God as somebody who demanded everything. It's true, nothing we do can save us. But the way we live when we're connected to God will demonstrate that we've been saved. Remember, Ephesians 2, 8, 9 says what? "For by grace you are saved through faith, that not of yourself, it's the gift of God, not of works," what? And then, what's verse 10? "For we are created in Christ Jesus unto..." That's right. And so here, Peter and them, they saw that Peter and John were willing to go to jail to show that they really believe what they said. Let's read on. "So the next day, the rulers, elders, and teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other men of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them, 'By what power and what name do you do these things?'" What do you think of that? Now it's the priest's family, okay? Mostly Sadducees. They bring them in before them, okay? Just the family. Similar to Jesus, They brought him first to Annas, then to Caiaphas, then the Sanhedrin. Okay? So similar, they're bringing him in private. Why are they doing it private? They want to establish some type of guilt on them so they can bring it to the Sanhedrin and get rid of them. And so notice, after a night in jail, verse 7, they had Peter and John brought in. By what power and what name do you do this? In verse 8, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple, and are asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel. It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Did Peter heal him? Did John heal him? Who healed him? Jesus healed him, because Jesus has risen from the dead. Remember, all power and authority is given unto me, heaven and earth. And it says here, verse 11, a key verse in the whole New Testament. Jesus himself used this verse. Jesus himself used this verse when he told a parable and said what? Remember the parable he told? He said, there was a man that owned a vineyard, and he lent out the vineyard to some men. And when the time of harvest came, he sent the people to collect the profit. And what did they do to the guy he sent? They beat him up. So he sent a second one. And what did they do to the second one? They killed him. So he sent more, and what did they do? They killed him or beat him. And finally, he sends his son. And what happens? He says, they'll respect my son, but what happened? They killed him and threw him out. And Jesus said, what do you think the owner of the house will do, or the vineyard, do when he comes? And what did the scribes and Pharisees say? Yep, and rent it out to somebody he can trust. And Jesus then said what? Haven't you ever read in the scripture, the stone that the builders rejected has become the head of the corner? You remember that? Jesus quotes it. Peter quotes it. Paul quotes it. Okay? This became one of the solid verses that were used to say that Jesus was that stone. Now, you know, there is a story behind that. Isaiah mentions the verse. Zechariah mentions the verse. And Ephesians, as well as Peter here. And it, in the context, it's that there's a story that was passed around among Israel, okay? So we have to take the record, although it's not in Scripture, of the story. The verses are there, but the story's not there. It was during Solomon when he brought in Hiram and his crew to build the temple for the Lord. What they would do is they would use no tools on the brick or anything. For the temple, they would assemble these bricks from a quarry, and then they would transport them in. And it was said that they were building the wall, and they were looking for the perfect brick for the corner of the wall so that could handle the weight, could handle the weather, so that it would not collapse. And they could not find a brick that would hold under the pressure. And in the middle of the temple area, there was a stone that they hadn't removed yet, and it was there. And somebody said, let's see if it fits. And they fit, and it fit perfectly. It held the weight. It had handled the weather changes and everything. And so became the statement, the stone the builders rejected. And Jesus was that stone, because he came to his own received him not. Finish the verse. John 1, 11 and 12. But to as many as received him, to them he gives the power to become the sons of God. And that word is authority, the authority to become the sons of God. So here Peter quotes it, and he says, this is the stone that the builders rejected. Salvation, here it is. Tell me if this is a true statement. Tell me if you believe it today. You may not believe it tomorrow, but do you believe it today? Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. You believe it? One person believes it. So, two people believe it. So let me ask you, all those people in the world that go through their life every day just living it as they should, will they be saved if they don't accept Jesus as a Savior? Okay, so this verse then isn't true for them.
It's true because Jesus has already paid the price. But there's something, I believe it's in the book of Zechariah, people will come to him and say, where did these wounds in your hands, where did you get them?
Mm-hmm. And
it says, I received them in the house of my friends. So they don't know the story, but the Holy Spirit's been leading them. And they've been following, even in the book of Romans, it says that everyone has a measure of truth. And if they're following it, then they're following Christ.
So you're saying those people are saved by what they did, not
by what they did, but for following the light. They were following Christ unbeknownst to them.
Does everyone believe that? You're not certain. Peter says salvation only comes through one man. Mm-hmm. Salvation only comes through him, for there's no other name under heaven by which men, what's the next word? Must be saved. Is that true? You are going to read that, are you? Read it for everybody. Okay, so that's saying by if they have God's law written in their heart, then, and they follow it, then they're saved. So they're saved by following the light, not by, saved by Jesus.
But they are, because he gave us the opportunity. If he had not done what he had done, they would have no opportunity. They could follow the law to their blue in the face. But if he hadn't paid that price, they would have been too no avail.
Okay.
So it's not salvation by works. It's what Christ has done that opens that door where people that don't have opportunity, they're living up to the light that God has shown them.
Mm-hmm.
I have a theory that we're all living up to a certain amount of light, and God is going to have to spend an eternity enlightening us more, because we see now dimly through a glass, as the book of Corinthians says.
Mm-hmm. But what if by following Buddha, they lived up to the light they had, and it led them on a good path? They loved their neighbor as themselves. They honored their parents. They didn't commit adultery. They didn't steal. They didn't kill. What if they did all those things because that's what the principles of Buddha is about? Why then? In their mind, they're saved by the principles that Buddha taught. Why then would they be saved? Because it says here that there's salvation only in one name. Because can't people live the same type of life as Christians by following the principles of Buddha? But I don't believe everyone believes that as a Christian.
No, I don't believe that either.
Okay. I don't believe everyone believes it's done.
Okay.
Yeah.
You have to demonstrate it.
Okay, so see, that's still the demonstration is what?
It's evidence.
Yeah.
Of the heart wanting to
lie. See, and that's why I think in the context of Romans 2, 14 to 16, and the context of the verse you gave, Barb, in...
It's
Wink, yeah.
Time for their
entrance. Oh, yeah, no, Wink Time of Entrance is...
No,
Wink of Time of Entrance is Corinthians. And so in Corinthians, I think if you look at the context a little bit deeper, it may not be saying all that you're saying. And I think you have to be careful by saying that if somebody lived a good life and they kept the Ten Commandments, and they only had one God, just Buddha, you have to look at it. I think the winking is a way to try to describe that God is providing them salvation, not on the basis of that. And I think what Peter is saying is more what your mom said, Bonnie, is that this verse is actually saying that you don't have to accept Jesus, but Jesus has provided salvation to everybody. And I think that sometimes that we can't get that in our head, that just like forgiveness. You mentioned that, Barbara. Forgiveness is offered to everybody. And I think last week, was I here last week? I can't remember. I'm sorry, guys. I'm just losing it. Yeah. Huh? And so what happened is we looked at that statement in David, that when David, before he confessed his sin, Nathan came and said what? God's already forgiven your sins. He didn't even ask. God's forgiveness is already there, isn't it? Peter's trying to say here is that Jesus has made it possible for everybody to be saved. And how else God works? I believe Paul was trying to explain it. Because in chapter 2, he's letting you know that, remember chapter 1, we all know chapter 1. Some people don't like chapter 1 today, okay? Just because of verses 20 to the end of the chapter. But also, we do love the verses in 16 and 17 of Romans 1. And so, but what happens is, when you get into chapter 2, he's establishing, can the Gentiles be saved or can they not be saved? And then in chapter 3, he's saying what? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And God has provided his Son that provides the way of salvation. That's chapter 3. And of course, then he goes back to the Jews in chapter 4 with Abraham. So we look at it that way, that how God's going to work on that, it is going to be fair and just. That's all we can say. And we are not saved by what we do. As Paul says in the verse we quoted, verse 10 of Ephesians 2 says what? We are created in Christ Jesus. And we could stretch that and say we're recreated in Christ Jesus, because we can use the parallel of, remember how you remember the verse? 2 Corinthians 5 what? 2 times 5 is?
17.
10. 17, you're right, Barb. 17 is a great verse because what it says, we are a new creation in Christ Jesus. Very good, Barb. 2, 5, 10. Yeah, everyone knew that 2 times 5 is not 17. Very well said. But yeah, this is an amazing statement that Peter, a Jew, remember the trouble that he had when Jesus went and visited the Syrophoenician woman? Get rid of her! Why are you even talking to her? That's what he said. This is Peter. Now what is Peter like? Salvation comes through Jesus. And you see, that's got to upset these guys, because remember, the real issue is about, what's the real issue today in life? Isn't it? Everything's about cash. What does it say? Verse 13. When they saw the courage of Peter and John, did that take a lot of courage to say that? Sure did. And realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, They were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. What is it about their statement? What is it now about Peter and John that made these guys realize they couldn't tell these stories and threaten them and put them in jail and beat them to change them, but that what? They were bold enough to speak to the high priest, his stepdad, who was Annas and Caiaphas, and the guards. They were threatened, but they didn't budge, just like Jesus. They tried to threaten him and what? They were just like, they knew they had been with Jesus. Something had happened to Peter. What happened to Peter when he came into the garden? It was cold. And he said, I got to get next to the hurricane heater. And what happened? He went to sleep? No. What happened? I'd never seen the man before. And it was the little girl that got him. What did she say? Oh, yeah. Yeah. And then one more time, the girl. It was the girl. It wasn't a guy. That's what made it bad. You know, if it was a guy, you know, Peter could have. But it was a little girl. He couldn't say no. This is that Peter, who they can't even threaten him now. But since, verse 14, they could see the man who was healed standing there with them, there was nothing they could say. Now, how do you like that transition? Peter and John are thrown in jail for the night. And who's the first one to come and see him? This guy. The healed guy. Is he afraid to stand before him? He's standing with Peter and John. So they ordered them to withdraw from the Sanhedrin and then conferred together. What are we going to do with these men? They asked. Everybody living in Jerusalem knows they have done an outstanding miracle, and we cannot deny it. But to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, we must warn these men to speak no longer to anyone in this name. How do you like that for a testimony? Did you hear what they said? We can't deny this guy was healed. Listen to him. This is the Sanhedrin. We cannot deny it. They're not even going to try to say nothing was wrong with him. What happened when Jesus healed the blind man in chapter 9 of John? They tried to dissuade him to not believe it. Remember? We don't believe he was born blind. Let's bring in his parents. He was born blind, but we don't know how he can see now. Well, we don't believe you. You're just what? You don't know anything. That's what they told him. And then he said what? Don't you know the only scripture that you say you believe? There's nobody that was miraculously healed if God didn't do it. And they said, what, you're trying to teach us now? And they threw him out. So now here, they said, we can't deny this miracle. What can we do? We know he was healed. We know he was crippled. So what are you going to do? How are you going to deny it? But we must stop this thing from spreading. We must warn these men to speak no longer in that name. They then called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John, the famous statement, that's why we love chapter 4. It's got the two great statements. The one is, there's salvation in no other name. There's no other name given among men by which we must be saved. And what's this next one? You already know what it is. What is it? Judge for yourself whether it's right in God's sight to obey you rather than him. For we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and what we have heard. Wait a minute. Tell me. You got to be thinking of 1 John chapter 1, verse 1, that says what? That which was from the beginning, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. What does John say? I'm not presenting anything to you that I myself have not seen, have not touched, have not handled. And why is he sharing it? So that you may have fellowship with us, because our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son. Peter says, and maybe that's John speaking, we can't say any other because we're telling you what we've seen and what we've heard. Do you know what type of testimony that is? It's an amazing testimony. A testimony that cannot be debated. Because if you tell other people, no matter what they say, if you tell other people what you have experienced, guess what? Doesn't matter what they say, because it's not going to change your beliefs. You know what happened to you. Because is it better for us to what? Obey God or man? You answer the question. It's better to obey God than man. After further threats, they let them go. They could not decide how to punish them because of all the people were praising God for what had happened. For the man who was miraculously healed was how old? Over 40 years old. Let's see, if he was 40 years old, and this somehow happened in the early 30s, and some kind of think this is close to being 34. If you take 34 to 40, what happens? You're talking 6, 7, 8 BC. Do you remember who reigned during that time? Who remembers? Herod the Great. Herod the Great got a visit one day from a group of men that came from the east. And they said, we're looking for him who is king of the Jews. Now, Herod was king, but not the right one. So he asked the leaders, where was he to be born? And they said, in Bethlehem of Judea. Called the wise men in, and what happened? He said, when did you see this star? They said, what? 2 years ago. Now we know Herod died in the year 6 BC. Okay? Are you with me? I'm sorry. Yeah, 6 B. I think it's 6. 4 or 6. That would mean this guy was born during that time. Now, we don't know for sure. And I'm not going to give you information that could go a long way or try to discourage you. But the possibility of this man being born in Jerusalem or Bethlehem, just a few miles away, during that time is pretty accurate. Because he said he was about 40. Okay, or over 40. He could have been one of the kids that was 2 years and under, whose parents tried to escape from getting him killed, and they dropped him. And he could have been paralyzed. Maybe. Nice story. Is there any truth to it? We don't know. Just trying to put you in perspective of his age and what happened when he was born, could have happened. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. And when they heard this, they all raised their voices together in prayer to God. Notice, they come back. They share the testimony of what happened to them. What happened? They spent the night in jail. Okay, what else happened to them? They were threatened. What else happened? They got to proclaim the resurrection. And so it says here, this is what they prayed. How do you remember what they prayed? Remember your prayers? Or are they said and you forget them? Do you ever remember any prayer that was said in church that just moved you so much that you remember it today verbatim? Okay, some are shaking, yeah. They remember the prayer verbatim. It says here, remember it says, they lifted their voice together in prayer. So this is probably not one person praying, but the whole group. And notice what it says. Sovereign Lord, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand and rulers gather together against the Lord or against his anointed. Of course, everyone knows what psalm that is from. Somebody tell me. Psalm 2. If you memorize Psalm 2, yeah. Those are usually ones people go through and memorize. Psalm 1, Psalm 2, Psalm what? There's a couple before that they memorize. What other one? Psalm 8, Psalm 13, Psalm 15, Psalm 22, Psalm 23, just to tell you. That's usually the order that they use, unless you're going to memorize them all. Okay? And Psalm 2 always says that. It's the first, we know it as the first prophecy concerning Jesus coming and also plotting against him. Verse 27. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. Notice, this is an amazing verse, because now what is the light on this? That Herod and Pilate met together. We always get the impression, what? They never met together. Here he says they met together with the Gentiles, not the Jews. Why didn't they meet with the Jews? Because it was a feast day, the Passover. If they went in, they defiled themselves. Okay? That's why they were not there. And what did they decide? Remember? Who are they talking to in this prayer? Us? Who are they talking to? Anybody know? Everybody sleeping? Who are they talking to? Okay? Let's go back to the verse so you remember in verse 24. Sovereign Lord. Who are they talking to? They're talking to God. When he says what? They what? They conspired against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. Jesus wasn't anointed by a person. He wasn't set aside for ministry by people. Because what happened? It wasn't John the Baptist that anointed Jesus. God sent the Spirit and anointed. Remember? Luke 4, 16 says what? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has what? Anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. So it's God who anointed him, not man, not John the Baptist. And it says here, they did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Listen to this prayer. What are they saying? They decided to what? Get rid of the one you anointed, but it's something that you predicted would happen. And it's something you allowed to happen. How many times in Jesus' ministry did they try to get rid of him and they couldn't? Many times. God permitted because that was God's plan. He wanted to save everybody. And the way he saw to do it is send his own son who could die for us so we could live. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Notice what Peter says. Don't let us shrink back just because of the threats. Give boldness to all the people that they will speak. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform miracles, signs, and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. Listen to this. People love this verse. I'm not sure it's the most popular verse in Seventh-day Adventist Church. Because you got to hear what Peter is saying here. And if you can grasp what Peter's saying here, I have to tell you, I was listening to a preacher last night. Now, I have to tell you, I did not listen to his whole sermon. I did not. Not because he wasn't a good preacher. Not because he didn't have a good message. I got what I needed to get out of the sermon. You understand? Is that fair for me to say? But can I tell you what he said in his sermon? His subject was about the woman who reached out and touched the hem of Jesus' garment. And in the sermon, he didn't use this verse, but it definitely was the verse he was thinking of, the preacher. Maybe not. Maybe that's just what I heard, because I knew where I was going to be tonight. Jesus said to the disciples, "Somebody touched me." And Peter said, "Are you crazy? There's thousands of people that touched you. What do you mean, who touched me?" And Jesus said, "No. Virtue has gone out of me." This is somebody, in spite of the crowd, in spite of all the demands on Jesus, because we know what the demand on Jesus was then, right? Because the demand on Jesus was then is I would be in the same place just like you would, Lawrence. Because what happened? There was a ruler of the synagogue, whose 12-year-old daughter was sick and the point of death. And Jesus was on his way and couldn't get there because of the crowd. He was on a mission to heal this girl. And somebody in the crowd reached out. Even though he wasn't looking for her, even though he wasn't going for her, what happened? She demanded healing from God, even though that was not his mission. Do you hear what Peter's saying here? Please, let me read it again. This, I hope, becomes one of your favorite verses. But not only that, as these were all kneeling prayer, they were claiming this promise. Listen to what it says again. I want you to go home thinking of this verse. Tomorrow morning, I want you to think of this verse. It says, "Give us great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform miraculous signs and wonders through the name of your Holy Servant, Jesus." Do you hear what he's saying? He's saying in prayer, we have the opportunity to say, "God, your plan may not be for today, for me, but I'm praying for a miracle of healing." Did you hear what he said? Perform miraculous signs. This is Peter speaking to God in prayer or one of the other people that are there, and they're saying, "God, perform a miracle. Show signs and wonders." Is that okay to ask that of God? Now, I have to tell you, please forgive me, okay? But he does not say, if we were praying that prayer today, what might our next few words be? Four words. It's not added here. And it wasn't omitted. It was just never part of the prayer. What does Peter or whoever is praying this prayer not say? You're not thinking tonight. There it is. If we close a prayer like that and say, "If it's your will," is it God's will? Yes. We don't have to add that. And that's what Peter's saying here. He's saying, he's not saying if it's your will. He knows it's God's will because what happened? They walked into the beautiful gate and said, "Silver and gold we have none, but we're only going to give you what we have." They didn't stop and say, "God, if it's your will." It was God's will. And what happened as a result of it? Who remembers? 2,000 people joined the church in one day. One day, 2,000 people joined the church. Peter says, "Do more miracles like that because we can add more than 2,000 a day." What does the miracle do? Why Peter asking for that? Peter's not interested in numbers. What's he interested in? Spreading the gospel and what? Salvation for everybody. And if a miracle will bring people to a knowledge of God, then guess what? We accomplished our purpose. Peter said, make us bold. Give us the ability to do this. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. How do you like that? It was shaken. Would you like this church to shake? It might fall. I'm only kidding, but maybe not. We know where the fault line is, right? You know it's right over here. Okay, you guys all know that. Lawrence, you know that too, right? Okay. I don't know. Would Bridges go first or would we go first? But I'm saying it. The place was shaken. Most of you have been in the earthquake in both 89, and some of us were also in the one in 94 in L.A. And you know what it's like to have place shaken, huh? Now, you know, I live on the bay, and when a big truck goes down our street, our house shakes. It really does. Christine said, do you know our house shakes? Yeah, it shakes. Has the church ever been shaken? He said, give us boldness. You think that gave everybody in the room boldness? And what's the conclusion? After they prayed, the place where they were shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And what's the last expression? And they spoke the word of God. How? Was it answered? What if he had said, if it's your will, God, what do you think would have happened? Think there would have been some boldness there? What if somebody says, go out and preach the gospel if you want to. Go hand out flyers in your neighborhood when it's sunshiny, 80 degrees. Oh, we got to drop it, 72. 80 is too hot for people to hand out literature, isn't it? That's what I've been told. I love this. And you realize why I'm stopping here? Because the chapter should end there, and verse 32 should be with chapter 5. Verse 32 should be chapter 5, verse 1. And if you want to read it now, you can find out why. But next week, you'll see how it goes to chapter 5, and you say, you're right, Pastor. Yeah, they divided it wrong. It should be with chapter 5. So we're going to end here tonight. But any questions? No questions? Shall we pray boldly tonight? Are you ready to be shaken? Are you ready to feel something tonight? Okay, let's pray. Father in heaven, we're grateful tonight that we can study chapter 4 in the book of Acts. And Father, we are amazed at the boldness of John and Peter. We know that when Jesus was when he stood before the Sanhedrin, when he stood before Caiaphas, and when he stood before Annas, Peter was pretty scared. But Father, something happened to him. He handled the word of life. He'd heard Jesus say to him, do you love me? Do you really love me, Peter? Peter, are you serious about loving me? Peter was a changed man. He was willing to give everything he had to a crippled man, and all he had was Jesus. And it was enough to cause a miracle to allow 2,000 more people to become believers. If a night in jail would do that for all of us, Lord, we would spend the night in jail. But Father, greater than that, it's when Peter and the group that were with them prayed. And all they did was ask one thing. They asked for boldness to speak your word. They asked for boldness to demand miracles, to cause things to happen, to bring peace and joy in people's life, but much more so, to complete the work of the gospel so that you could come back and bring us to our heavenly home. Father, we're grateful for the salvation in no other name. That's what gives us the assurance tonight that we can be bold and share the things that we've experienced. Father, we're asking for miracles in our church so that the city of Fremont, 200,000 people plus, may hear this message. Father, watch over each one tonight, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, next week, we're going to do chapter 5. Have a great week. I'll miss you all at church this week. I'll be up in Livermore. And pray for me, too. I'm starting a new book up in Livermore, and it's the book of Joshua. And so I've been studying and wrestling with the book of Joshua this week. So pray for me, and have a good night.